In-depth sports coverage from The Athletic is now just £1 a month with an introductory offer. See the link in the description to sign up. The prevailing trend among the biggest and best teams is to play with pace, high pressing, and often positional play, the attempt to win superiority in certain areas of the pitch with overloads or freeing a team's best players to attack weaker, isolated defenders through patterns of movement and the occupation of certain zones. To counter this, some teams have used a passive low block. Generally, a low block is a sign of weakness. While some teams, like Mourinho's Inter Milan or Simeone's Atletico Madrid, have found success with one, this is because they've partnered it with lethal counter-attacking in transition and very high-quality defenders. But teams who employ a low block don't usually challenge for honours. It's more about security. So, when we talk about a low block, what exactly do we mean? Well, low simply describes the area of the pitch, the defensive third. And all teams will have some instances where they have to defend this area, and even energetic pressing sides don't press as aggressively. The low block in this sense therefore requires a degree of passivity, retreating towards the goal and attempting to compact space regularly, and the absence of a press in the opposition's defensive third. So how best to approximate a low block statistically? Well, according to Opta, these five teams had the lowest average start distance of each of Europe's top five leagues. That is, the average distance in meters from their own goal that a team's open play sequences start. Another approximation might be the percentage of a team's pressures that occur in the attacking third. This data from FBref.com and StatsBomb shows that three of the sides in the above table are also in the bottom 10 for percentage of pressures in their attacking third, or the opponent's defensive third. So the kind of teams that might be described as having a low block as a function of system rather than situation defend deep, start their attacks deep, and are more passive the higher up the pitch they are without the ball. On the pitch, teams playing this way will look to congest the middle and compress the space vertically. This means, in effect, that they try to leave as small a gap as possible between their defensive and their midfield lines, and will often drop the attacking line back as well. This, of course, makes them hard to attack. But how do you beat a low block? Well, given the relative absence of a high press, it's tough to draw these teams forwards to leave space in behind. Set pieces can work, of course, but they can against any team. It's worth noting, though, that looking at assists conceded from set pieces in the Premier League last year, Burnley, Wolves and Newcastle, probably the three most low block system teams, conceded below average numbers of set pieces. Having a go from outside the box makes more sense, as the back line has retreated, and if you can get a shot away, more on this later, it can be effective. Burnley conceded 18% of their goals from outside the box, Newcastle 13.8% and Wolves 7.5%. The average was 11.9, so only Wolves bettered that. And all three teams had good goalkeepers last season. There are two main ways to score against a low block though, playing with width and playing through. The first is easier and can also generate chances for long shots. As low block teams like to be compact, this can leave space in the wide areas, both close to and further from the goal line. And there are two ways to exploit this. The first is to break quickly into the wide areas and look to have runners coming from deeper positions that can take defenders by surprise, often from positions between the two defensive lines. This has two possible effects. Either the near side fullback stays narrow to protect the shape, in which case the attacker can get a cross in, or the near side fullback goes out to block the cross, which leaves a space somewhere else. This could be the channel between that fullback and the near side centre back, which can then be attacked. Or it could be on the far side of the pitch. As the defensive line moves horizontally across to maintain spacing, this can allow for players on the far side to enter the box unmarked. A cross pulled into the centre and then quickly played out or half cleared to an opponent can then find a player in space to attack the far side. And this can also be achieved by quick switches of play. Liverpool excel at this, as do Bayern Munich, stacking one side of the pitch against a low block, drawing the opposition over and then hitting a switch pass that finds the open far side, attacking it at pace. Playing through is harder and requires technical players who can again find the spaces between the lines and achieve quick interchanges. Movement is key. You need players arriving at pace into the danger area, even if part of the pressing move is one static player who receives and passes on. Finding space between the lines is hard, and so players have to arrive between the lines as the ball does, then burst beyond before they can be closed down. Both of the above situations can also generate chances to shoot from distance. A player arriving at pace can shoot from in front of the last line of defence, which can obscure a goalkeeper's view. And players who are found in wide areas can have shooting opportunities, cutting quickly inside as the defence try and scramble back across. Again, this can pose issues for keepers with deflections or an obscured field of vision. So it definitely is possible to score against teams playing in low block systems. Lecce, one of the teams mentioned above, had the worst goals conceded record in Europe's top five leagues last year. Being hard to break down is an alternative to trying to attack when you don't have the quality, and this can also extend to the defence. But it's a conundrum faced by better sides regularly, a consequence perhaps of the financial disparities within the game, and that's why these sorts of attacking moves have become increasingly common. The Athletic is in-depth sports coverage that helps fans see the game from every angle. And TIFO is delighted to be able to offer full access to The Athletic now for just £1 per month. See the link in the description for details of this introductory offer. For football fans, that's access to the writing of journalists dedicated to your team, plus David Ornstein, Phil Hay, Daniel Taylor, and many more. Not to mention over 400 full-time writers offering inside access and independent analysis of every team that you follow across every league that you care about. Get local expertise and unmatched league-wide perspective. The Athletic's writers are in the bubble, on the field, and behind the scenes as it all happens. Catch up, go deep, and join the conversation on the most important happenings in sports.